Hi team, session 20, Linux file system format. Meaning is formatting the file systems or making file system on the partitions or creating file systems on the partitions. This is Linux essential series. You know my name is Ram. Okay, agenda of the session is file system formats, standard formatting file systems, some standard file system, generaling file systems, file system format commands, some generaling file systems, then mkfs commands, swap volume, file system check commands, and working with file systems. File system is actually when the disk is ready to store the files, or when you can you mount it and create files on the partition, on the disk. Something like when you first step is you add a disk. Second step is you create LVM or RAID. Then third step is you create partitions on that, or maybe on the disk. So second and third step basically they are the same, like you create RAID volumes or LVMs or partitions directly. And then the last step, before you make use of the disk, before you start creating files on the disk, you make a file system on the disk. If you have been using pen drives or Windows systems, you know what is the term format. We format the pen drive, we format the disk, which means that we delete everything, we erase entire data, and we make the disk usable again. Essentially, what does this mean? There's a two way to look at it, which is not discussed in the session, but I'll demonstrate it, I'll explain it right now. One view is the system view and one is the user view. If I say the user view, for me, user look at it from the point of view of the directories concept, like we have root directory, then we have slash dev directory, then we have slash home directory, and we have slash root directory, we have slash etc directory. This is the user view of looking at the disk, because when you see, when you use ls command, you see these kind of directories on your system, and that's very easy to understand. So you know that we have the concept of directories on the system. This is the user view, the way we look at it. However, we should also need to understand that the disk is actually nothing but a platters put on a spinner which rotates with a very high speed, and the heads moves on the platters and read the data on the disk or the plates. So disk, plates, magnetic oxide layer on the disk, this gives an altogether different impression. True, that is what the disk is all about, and the disk is this. So this is the disk, but we see the disk in this way. This is our way of looking at the disk. How this, which is the gap or the mapping, this is actually done by the file system. So file system is essentially the first disk, outermost cylinder has a table called inode table. That table consists of the list of all the files and directories on the disk, like this list I'm talking about. So that file system table or inode table is created when you format the disk and when you make a file system on it. In other words, the raw disk is converted into a smart disk where the inode table is created, and the blank inode table, because there is no file as of now, and it is available for use. That is what the concept of file system is. So while RHEL can work with many of the file system formats, the default is XFS. So XFS is the name of the file system. Every file system, like in Windows you use NTFS file system, in Linux there are other file system like ext2, ext3, ext4, XFS, these are all file systems, and SUSE Linux use BTRFS file system. So there are many other file systems, ZFS file system, BTRFS file system, XFLs. Why we have so many of them? Because each of them offer a different set of characteristics and properties. They have their own advantages and disadvantages. Although many users enable other file systems such as BTRFS, which is a default in SUSE Linux, Red Hat may not support them. Linux supports a rich variety of file systems. The NTFS file system, DOS file system, XFS file system. So we, other than formatting it, other than making a file system, we don't do anything else with the file system. I mean, once the file system is created, once you start using it, you hardly get into the file system concept again, unless there's a problem developed or snag developed in the disk, because you have to use file system check. You have to repair the file system in that scenario. Most file systems incorporate features such as journal-based file systems or journal-based transactions, large storage support, delayed allocation, complex algorithm to optimize read and write performance. Let's understand each one of them. Features such as journal-based transactions. Journal means logging. Whatever you do, you keep a log of that. Which means it, in order of crash, you can recover that. That is journaling. Large storage support, meaning is self-explanatory. Delayed allocation, the data first goes to the cache and then it is written to the disk, because the user interaction, if it is done in RAM, that is faster. So allocation of the disk and storage in the disk will be done at the back end. So we use buffer concept, input buffer, output buffer. So that will help in, you know, doing this write, disk write utility at the back end, disk write activity at the back end. So delayed allocation of the disk onto the data. Then complex algorithm to optimize read and write performance. This is also self-explanatory because we are talking about optimization of read and write. This is by definition what is file system format, and it gives you an idea about the file system formats. There are two broad categories of the file systems: standard formatting and journaling. Standard formatting is where we don't have a concept of file system journals, and journaling means where we have the tracking or logs of the activities which we do on the file system so that we recover in case of crash. While this is oversimplification, correct, but it is sufficient to categorize the file system important to Linux in order to understand the two different categories or two broad categories of file systems. However, Linux kernel can make it possible to set up more file systems. The Linux file systems were developed to mimic the functionality of Unix file systems available at the time. The first version of Linux operating system used the extended file system called ext. In the 20th century, Red Hat formatted this partition to second extended file system, ext2. When I started working on Linux, we used to have ext file system. I remember using ext file system. I remember using ext2 file system when I was working on Linux for the first time. In RHEL5, it was ext3 file system. In RHEL6, it was ext4 file system. And in RHEL7 and 8, we have XFS file system. So this is the sequence and series. In fact, the improvement, you can see the how they have grown over a period of time from ext to XFS. The size of the current file system has increased the importance of journaling, because such file systems are more resilient to failure. The file system such as ISO 9660, this is for your DVD or CD, and SWAP are still in common use, because you use DVD, that is the file system is ISO 9660, and SWAP space, you know, the SWAP space is used for swapping the files from RAM in case we require more space for files. So we swap some of the pages from the memory to the disk to accommodate the newly or new pages which are required by the processor. These are some of the standard file systems which are not journaling file system, ext2. Though we don't use them nowadays, other than the swap and ISO 9660. ext2, it was earlier used up to RHEL4, This was the foundation of EXT3. Swap, we know what is the purpose of swap. It is associated with the dedicated swap partitions. You probably created one swap partition when you installed Linux RHEL 7. MS-DOS and VFAT, it allow you to read MS-DOS formatted file system. No point talking about it. Why? Because you won't be using it, because we use pre-Windows 95, old version of Windows 95 we used it. VFAT lets you read Windows 98, 95, NT, 2000, XP, Vista, Windows 7 partitions formatted to FAT16 or FAT32 file system. These are Windows based file system if you have ever used Windows machines. ISO 966 is a standard file system for CD-ROMs. It is also known as High Sierra File System or HSFS. PROC and SYS, these are two virtual file systems. Virtual means the file system does not occupy any disk space. They are only in the RAM. They are only in the memory and they are created as needed. Used to provide information on kernel configuration and devices status, because you can see the PROC file system being used for the processes, because ultimately, as I said, everything is Linux is a file. If you want to see your process files, you can see the PROC file system. If you want to see the SC Linux, Security Enhanced Linux file systems, you can see the SYS file systems. So you can see everything if you go into these file systems. They are virtual, they are not physical in nature. They are not stored on the disk. TempFS is file system stored in memory, used for RHEL7 for /run partitions. So these are some of the standard partitions which are used, which are not journaling based file system. Then comes the journaling file system. Journaling file system have two main advantages. One, they are faster for Linux to check during the boot process. Second, if the crash occurs, the journaling file system has a log, that is journal, that can be used to restore the metadata for the files on the relevant partition, means repair the file system. For RHEL7, the default file system is XFS, as I said earlier also. And this is what we will be creating now, because we already have the partitions which we created in the previous session. It is a highly scalable journal based file systems. However, this is not the only journaling file system available. Volumes formatted to XFS can theoretically be as large as 8 exabyte, kilobyte, megabyte, terabyte, gigabyte. You know the scale, and you should check what is the meaning of 8 exabytes. That's a serious increase over the maximum size of EXT4 volume, which was up to 16 terabytes only. Meaning is you can go of the size, you can handle the file system, or you can handle a disk of as large as 16 terabyte or as large as 8 exabyte if you're using XFS file system. XFS supports a large number of concurrent operations, guarantee space for files, and guarantee faster checks, and more features are offered by this XFS file system. Several commands can help you. This is the real agenda of the session, was the making a file system, and this is that command, and this is what I'm going to demonstrate after this slide is over. Several commands can help you in creating a file system on the partitions. They all are based on the mkfs command, which works as a front end to the file system specific command, such as mkfs.ext3 or mks.ext4 or mkfs.exfs. So you can use these commands, mkfs.xfs. If you want to reformat an existing partitions, logical volumes or RAID array, make sure that you make the backup of the data, unmount the partition. You cannot format it. You cannot make a file system on the mounted partition. You first have to unmount it. Naturally, you cannot cut the branch of the tree on which you are sitting. So you cannot format a file system, or you cannot format a partition if you are working on the partition, the partition is being used. So you have to make sure that you are not using that partition. So because it will erase the entire data, so you should know, first you need to back up the data. So back up the data, unmount the partition, and then you format it. Command is quite simple, mkfs -t stands for which file system you are making on it, XFS, and the partition on which you want to make the file system. Or it is one of the same thing, you can use mkfs.xfs. Both commands are same. You can use either of the two. Let's see that, and let's create the partitions. Let's make a file system on the partitions which we created. So let's see the demonstration. One single command, and that was the agenda of the day. And if you notice, these were the partitions which we created last time. This is my second disk which I added. If you want, we can take a look at again fdisk -l /dev/sdb, and these are the partitions which we created. We have only one partition which can be used, which can on which I can create a file system, because swap, I don't use mkfs for creating a swap partition. For that I already demonstrated the command which was mkswap and then swap on, if you remember that. I don't know whether you recollect that or not. Mkswap and swap on. So for this was already demonstrated in the previous session. LVM, first we need to create the LVM and then only we can create it. So let's create, in fact, let's change the system ID of this partition also, so that we can create two different file system on these two partitions. So let's use it. fdisk /dev/sdb, and partition system ID is to be changed. So you know the command is t, change the partition system ID, which we did in the previous session. So I'm using t command, partition number 3, and the system ID is 83, I remember. Now print the partition table again, and now it is correct. So I can format this file system now and write and exit. Now I can make a file system on that. Now I have two Linux file system types, the first partition sdb1 and sdb3. Now the commands which I am talking about: mkfs -t xfs, and the partition cdev/sdb1. This is how you create a partition. And done. Make a file system. Sorry, this is how you create a file system. So I have created the file system. Job is done. If you want to create another file system on partition number 3 and of type ext4, you can simply replace it ext4. You can also use this by typing a dot followed by the partition type mkfs.ext4/dev/sdb3, and this is done. Both file systems are formatted now and are ready to be mounted and being used, and you can use them. That was the command which was the objective of this session, and that's what we have done. So this was a single command to make a file system, and I'm sure now you will not forget it. Was very simple command, mkfs. So ext4 was a default file system in RHEL 6. FX is the default in RHEL 7, developed by Silicon Graphics for a journaling file system. It supports very large files and features such as B-tree indexing and dynamic allocation nodes. JFS is IBM general file system, commonly used for IBM enterprise servers. BTRFS is a journaling or B-tree file system developed to offer a set of features comparable with Oracle ZFS. These are all file systems, and it is common. It is actually default file system on your SUSE Linux enterprise server. And TFS is Microsoft Windows file system. So these are name of the file systems. You just need to just have an idea about the different file systems. The commands which I have demonstrated already, the options available with RHEL7 includes mkfs.ext3 to make a ext3 file system. I demonstrated ext4, in fact. mkfs.ext4 to format a volume for ext4 file system. mkfs.fat It is for DOS based systems. MKFS.exFS, which I demonstrated using hyphen T. It is one and the same thing, whether you use MKFS space hyphen T XFS. And MKSwap I demonstrated in the previous session to format a swap space. More on MKFS command. All options command assume that you have configured an appropriate partition in the first place, as I told you. But because that was a prerequisite, the session which I discussed, you know, in the previous session, that is a prerequisite, because unless you have a partition, unless you have the disk and partition, where will you make a file system? Obviously, that is the true. For example, before MKSwap can be properly applied to partition, Linux swap partition ID must be configured, which we learned. And just now also we did, we changed the partition system ID from Linux LVM to normal Linux. And in the previous session, we changed the partition system ID from normal Linux to Linux LVM, and then to swap also, and we use mkswap command also. So swap volumes, although swap can be although Linux swap can use swap files, the swap space is generally configured in properly formatted partitions or logical volumes. To see the swap space currently configured, you can use cat proc swaps. Let's take a look at. So cat slash proc slash swaps, and you see only one swap is available. Though you may ask, we created a swap partition last time, and we made a file system also on that, a swap partition, and we can make we converted that into swap. But why that is not being used? Because that require a swap on command, or the entry has to be made into slash etc slash fstab. Let's take a look at whether we have that entry into fstab or not. Slash etc slash fstab. We did not do this command, so therefore that's why we are not able to see the swap partition being available right now. But how can we make available the partition which we created? So command is quite simple. Swap on, swap swap on slash dev slash sdb2, because you know that swap partition was our second partition. And now if we see cat command, you see the second swap is also available. See, here it is. This is not swap on. Yeah, this is it. You see the swap partition is now effective and available. So this is how we can make the swap available. So we need to use the command swap on in order to make the swap available to be used by the system. So for swap, there are three steps. Step number one, add a disk or partition. Step number two, use mkswap to format the partition for being used to be used by swap. And third, you use swap on command, or you make an entry into fstab for that same purpose. Alright, that's how you can use the swap partitions. So that the three steps are there for swap. So cat proc swaps will show you the swap partition being used. Swap volumes are formatted with mkswap command. We discussed it in the previous session. The swap volume must be activated with swap on command. So first, change the partition system ID to swap. Second, use mkswap command. Third, use swap on command. If a new swap volume is recognized, you'll see the entry into proc swap file, and that's how we see that. Also, you can use the top command to see the swap space, and also to make it available after the system is rebooted, you have to make an entry into etc fstab, and that's why my swap was not visible when I used for the first time just now the cat command. When I used cat command for the first time, I could not see the second swap space, that is sdb2, because the entry was not into fstab. If I make entry into fstab, the proper entry into fstab, I can see that every time swap is available, the second swap which I created. Then we have the file system check command, fsck command. You don't have to do anything else. Only thing is that the file system, the partition should not be mounted, and that's it. FSCK command analyze the specified partition and perform repair as required. Suppose we are having problems with the files in WAR, which is mounted on SDA7. If you want to run FSCK, first is unmount that file system. You means the command is umount. In some cases, you may need to go into the rescue mode before you can unmount the file system. Reason for this is quite obvious, because if you are using a mandatory file system like etc or lib or some other commonly used /home, you have to go to the rescue mode because you cannot unmount that when you are using the system. So you may have to go to the rescue mode. To unmount, analyze and then remount the system, the sequence of command is umount, the partition location where it is mounted, FSCK, file system check, and this is same concept as we use with MKFS, that is -t and the file system type. So FSCK-t XFS and the partition, and then mount it again and the job is done. This is so easy to use the file system check command, FSCK command. FSCK command also serve as a front end depending on the file system format. For example, if you are formatting ext2, ext3 or ext4 file system, FSCK by itself automatically calls e2 FSCK. In fact, fsck.ext2, fsck.ext3, fsck.ext4, e2 FSCK, all they are different name of the same command. So make it universal, use the same concept always. Make it one habit. Either use with a dot, like mkfs dot fsck dot. So mkfs dot ext4, fsck dot ext4, mkfs dot xfs, fsck dot xfs. And since you will never be using these file system because they are gone, they are all old now, so no point to even remember them, to be honest, because now you are using XFS file system. So you have to remember only one command, XFS. So to repair the file system which I just created, just I'm assuming that there's some problems in the file system and I need to repair that. So how do I repair that? Let's take a look at that also. So I want to repair my first file system which I have developed some snag or some problems and it's not able to, the file system is corrupt. So what do? I know it is not mounted anywhere, so I can simply issue the command fsck.xfs/dev. xfs/dev/sdb1, and this is the command. That's it. So it's already simple. It's quite easy. Or .ext4. It says if you wish to check the consistency of XFS file system or repair a damaged file system, then the command is XFS repair. So we have, for XFS we have the command, as it is suggested by the this output only, the command is XFS_repair. That's good thing. That's what it is done. So this is for XFS file system, we have the command XFS_repair, but for others we have dot operator. That's interesting to note. For XFS file system the command is XFS_repair, but for others, like it is ext4, let me use the command ext4, and we have created that on the partition number 3. So fsck.ext4 /dev/sdb3, and this is how we can check the partition, and this is done. So this is basically for ext4 and earlier versions, the fsck command. For XFS we have the command xfs_repair. Remember that this is the command for repairing XFS file system. So working with file system, we have already done that, making a partitions which we created, fdisk, using the partition, displaying the partition, making a file system on it, and then review the current status. We can use dump to fs command, -h and the partition name, grep test listing. Same way, fsck file system check command, dev sdb1, mounting it once the partition is created, once the file system is created, and then verifying it. Quite simple. And then unmounting it. We have already created, mounted the file systems. And that is mkfs command, making a file system, ext4 file system on sdb partition. Dump etufs command is good to see the output and to see the partitions. Dump etufs, see the difference between output now and the partition was created. So this is a sequence of command which you can try to verify what you have done. And that's all for this session. Thank you very much for watching. Bye bye.